Coming up, we take a look at how the New York Football Giants continue to dodge serious injury concerns over the course of the preseason, the way the offensive line has come together, and the potential for a young rookie to make some hay, but ultimately the secondary and where our concern levels could be if we don't see some real improvements from the on-field product. We go ahead and dive in next. Yes, my friends, it's OGP, the One Giant Podcast, where you know that we are your hosts. Over here, Adam Armbrecht. Over there, Andrew Mackowitz. We're healthy, we're wealthy, we're wise. And if you were here yesterday live on YouTube, you walked right through the emotions of the Tyrone Tracy Jr. with me. We went into the darkest possible caveats of losing him for the entire year to coming back out. Andy could not handle it. It was too much for him. It would have rocked his world to its core. So I got you through it. And now we come out the other side where Andy actually even has a more optimistic view on how the Giants have operated this season when it comes to these injury concerns across the board.
Yeah, it's funny. You know, Bobby Skinner, who does a great job for Talking Giants, they were at Patriots camp and he got the news of the injury. And like his second tweet after like, oh no, I'm worried, was like, is Tyrone Tracy ever going to get on the field? He's not back until 2026. He'll be 27 years old. He's going to be filing for retirement. He's going to get his AARP card. Like, is he ever going to play a snap for the Giants? Right. And that was the feeling I think that all of us had. And the reason why I bring that up is because the way the Giants have been injured, the Giants have had a ton of injuries in this camp. I mean, there's so many that I'm just going to name a couple of them, right?
Sure.
You have Tyrone Tracy yesterday, where it seems like we dodged a bullet there. You had Malik Nabers, the first round draft pick, come up limping on his leg. We're like, oh my gosh, is he even going to be ready for week one? He seems to be fine. You had Drew Locke go down with an oblique and a hip pointer. You're like, is he like seriously hurt? What's going to happen? He seems like he's going to be ready for week one. You've had Jay Kubis be hurt. You've had John Michael Schmitz not be out there for quite a bit. You've had a whole host of players.
Evan Neal, your favorite player.
Evan Neal is just coming off the pup list. I mean, Cordell Flott was kept out. The Giants have had a ton of injuries, Adam. But when you look around the league, the Giants have been actually pretty fortunate with how these injuries have all played out. You look at Rondell Moore for the Falcons tearing his ACL. He's out for the year. You look at J.J. McCarthy, a potential Giants target with their first-round pick. Torn meniscus, out potentially 6 weeks. The 49ers had to cancel practice with the Saints because they have 26 people injured on their roster. They don't have enough players to actually compete. And so when you think about it, the injury bug is going across the NFL. And so far, all of the injuries the Giants have had seem to be manageable. Even Deontay Johnson in a walking boot, it feels like he's kind of week to week. You feel like he may be back the first or second week of the season. The Giants have been very lucky, even with all of these injuries.
Yeah, I mentioned it yesterday. The only guy that Brian Daboll has pointed to and said that's a longer term one in terms of the players that he was discussing at the time of the press conference was Lawrence Cager with the groin. And that's one that maybe, and I looked at that. You should go, I mean, watch every episode and listen to every episode. But when I talked about that, it's like the tight end room is getting a little funky behind Daniel Bellinger. You're waiting for your rookie to rise. And things like groins, those can tend to be a little bit longer. But even in saying that, you're talking about a guy that you want to be a contributor. You're not talking about taking away one of your starting role players out of your rotation. I think you're right. And I just don't know. It's like the NFL and moving towards 18-game seasons and getting rid of another preseason game. And this is now, I think about it sometimes with baseball, it seems to be a problem for them too. It's like the less reps that you get, NBA suffers this too. It's like, wow, we can't have back-to-backs. We can't do this. We can't do that. And then yet you see injuries happen more. Now, NFL is the most violent of any of the sports that goes on. So I think it's just the nature of the game. But I don't know how do you safeguard? You're losing players like this is absolutely brutal. And it happens every year. So it's not like this is anything new. Fingers crossed, knock on wood, cross everything you can. Because if the Giants can get through this offseason and not have some of those high-level injury concerns, then it does mean that sometimes it is about how healthy are you to start? Catch some teams off guard. How healthy are you getting through the year? That can mean some wins and losses in critical weeks.
Adam, I was going to turn the question back to you. You asked it to me, but I may ask it back to you.
Thank you.
The Giants have 4 weeks until the regular season starts. They have two more preseason games that they have to worry about.
That's right.
Like they've been very fortunate so far, but we're only like a couple weeks into training camp and one preseason game.
Oh, yeah, that's
we have way more than that fast approaching. And like, to your point, I don't know how you safeguard against it. How can the Giants manage all of this to make sure that they have the optimal team ready for week one that is prepared to play week one against the Vikings?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty hard. You can't, essentially, because, I mean, guys need reps, right? And at a very high level, rules that you know, it's like why Darius Slayton didn't play in the first preseason game. You sure you want to get him out there and get him a couple of reps if Jones is going to be out there on the field? I mean, the high-level question would be, should Jones see the field at all in preseason? But again, you go and you look just across the stadium and Aaron Rodgers, he walks out there week one last year and he's like, four plays, I'm done. See you later. Like, so there's no guarantee. And I think if you, what's that, you know, prepare to fail and you fail to prepare. So it's like, you got to get the reps. You need to see these guys out there. But as soon as you feel like you've checked the boxes that you need, go ahead and safeguard them against any potential injuries, especially when it comes to in these preseason games against Houston and then against the Jets to close things out. When you see them turn over to their depth pieces, you need to be ready to say, how far do we want to go with any of our starters against backups? Because that a lot of times in preseason games is sometimes when things get a little bit looser, a little more chaotic, right? And sometimes you end up getting guys injured. But you can't. There's nothing that you can do here. And the only spot that I think you would zero in on is the offensive line. You have new players coming in. You're going veteran heavy now across that line with Runyon Jr., with Van Roten, with Illuminor. So don't risk any of those players potentially beyond what you think you need to. Thankfully, familiarity with two of those guys in Brasillo, like, we should feel pretty good about walking into week one if all of these guys are healthy. Now it's about determining who's the depth pieces there and how do we want to fill out that roster in that room. That's probably the biggest one, knowing the history of the offensive line in recent years for the Giants, that you want to try to get out of this summer feeling like everybody is good to go.
Yeah, that's the tough part. All these veterans have not played with each other. The only two people that potentially were even on this roster last year were John Michael Schmitz and Andrew Thomas, both who got injured last season. About three new players across the offensive line, presumably in Illuminor, Runyon, and Van Roten.
The dream is they go, and we're going to talk about, you know, Houston as the week closes out, but the dream is they walk out there, they play two, three series, full offensive line in front of Daniel Jones. It looks nice and clean and crisp. And they go, great. Thanks so much. See you later. The last thing you want is to go. And this isn't even a concern, but just, you know, you go out and say, oh, some missed assignments. We didn't quite have our communication right there on those, right? Like, you'd like to see that be as minimal as possible to let you know, hey, when we go to regular season, we're pretty much set and forget here when it comes to the front.
Yeah. And while we have concerns about, you know, the team gelling, making sure they kind of are all connected together, it already feels better under Carmen Brasillo than it did last season. And knowing that a lot of these guys are veterans, we're not just throwing, you know, rookies or second year guys, you know, right out there at this point. It's surprising to say, Adam, but I feel like I am less concerned about the offensive line than I am other areas on this roster going into week one. That feels good, but it also feels bad. It's like, we finally may have corrected the mistake or challenge that we've had for years and years and years. But like, it feels like whack-a-mole, doesn't it? It's like, you think you solve one problem and then another one inherently pops up for you.
So I'm going to go the other way with this. I'm just going to say it feels good that the offensive line feels like it's in a good spot. I'm not going to say, and then something else pops up, because one, this is what happens with rebuilding teams. What happens, it's the reason why you have a 6-win team, you know, why you struggle, why you miss playoffs consistently, because you have a lot of areas of need. So I'm just happy that one area has been checked. We brought in veterans. It feels like we're confident in them. Everyone's getting into their positions. Okay, let's assume that while, and even to the extent of, well, where does Evan Neal fit if he comes back? Who cares? Where, you know, Ken Stinney, he's a veteran. He's getting some good reps. Talked about it a little bit yesterday. Even Kubis, a rookie. Okay, all these conversations. As long as I feel like my starting unit is in pretty darn good shape heading towards the regular season, I'm taking that win. And then, yes, there's other areas, but I'm going to enjoy it, Andy. I'm going to savor that something looks good, that things are going well on certain spots on this roster.
I have one question for you on the offensive line, then we can work towards the areas that we do have concerns with.
Sure.
What is the number ranking that the offensive line, if someone came to you and said, you can sign this piece of paper right now, and that is the ranking that the Giants will have as an offensive line, what is the worst number that you would sign up for immediately before the season? Because the Giants have been anywhere between the 32nd, 31st, or 30th ranked offensive line over the last 5 years, like consistently. If someone came to you and said, you could sign up for the 21st ranked offensive line this season, like, are you writing that one down? Are you putting that in pencil and worried about erasing it? If they said the 12th best offensive line, you obviously would sign the piece of paper tomorrow. So what the one question before we turn over is, what's the number that you would sign up for?
Yeah, it's interesting. If you told me that it was more young players, like say they had drafted more guys and they looked good, but they were young on the offensive line, you might feel differently about where you want them to rank this year and just saying good growth, good development, like the long-term future. The Giants went a different route here. They went with veteran talent that they brought in. We have all these guys that are going to be in their 30s getting into this line here that we brought into the room. 21st overall would probably be I probably wouldn't love that at this point, honestly, because you'd be saying, if you're splitting between two things, maybe we're 14th best in run protection, right? Looked pretty good here in the first preseason game. But that means that your pass protection has to be like 24th in order to come to 21 there. So I'd say I need them to be top 20 probably. If you told me that I could sign up for 17th offensive line overall, that means that I'm probably no worse than 20th in either pass or run, and I'm a little bit closer to 10 than I am to 20 in one of those categories too. So yeah, give me top 17, and I'm good to go for the year.
You know, it's funny because we didn't talk about this pre-show at all, but my number is 18. So I'm in the same boat as you. I'm like, if you give me like bottom half, but not the worst, like I think I'd sign up for that just because it's been so bad for so long for the Giants. But it is an interesting way that you mention it. This is a veteran group. They're not all signed to five-year deals. You expect them to be better this year as opposed to developing young talent that's going to be here for a long while. I couldn't agree with you more.
Let's turn our attention over to what is a potential concern. I mentioned this yesterday. Dan Duggan did a great job kind of high level bullet pointing out takeaways after the Tracy Jr. injury that we seem like we've avoided a serious scare on. He made a note about a spot on this team that is maybe going unchecked in terms of concern levels. And ironically, I may actually push back against this as well. I may be going too optimistic. We'll dive into the secondary coming up here in just one moment. As we turn our attention over to the defensive side of the football, we remind you that today's episode is brought to you by Personam. Personam is an AI-driven threat detection system that allows you to see into your network security and all of the threats that are coming your way, and allows you to do it better with their tools and platforms than any other option out there. Personam is always vigilant, always learning, and you can check out all of their features over on personam.ai. That's personam.ai. Check them out today. And okay, we turn our attention over to the secondary. And this is where, per Dan Duggan, and I'll reiterate this because I don't think I mentioned it. I alluded to it yesterday. And it was that when we talk about where we are on the offensive line, some players, some injuries. But all of the focus, Dan Duggan said, has been on the question at cornerback two across from Tae Banks on the defensive side. Maybe that's because it's too scary to think about what it'll mean if Deontay Banks isn't ready to be a true number one. He got beat by Slayton on a go route on the second play of the practice. That's happened enough in camp to cause some uneasiness about Banks heading into the season with huge expectations. Point stop. Before we get into the secondary in totality and some PFF grades coming out of the Detroit game, where do you stand on Tae Banks? Because you and I had a discussion earlier this offseason with rankings and where Tae Banks did not show up at the NFL level to quarterback spot and felt like it was a little bit getting downplayed how well and strong he looked down the stretch of the season a year ago.
I think we have to take a more critical lens at Tae Banks and his development. I think you and I want to be excited. We're fans at heart too while we do this, and we want him to be that number one cornerback, 100%. Lock it down, consider half the field taken care of. And we just haven't seen that yet. And while he is still a young player, he can still ascend. We really need him to take on a leadership role in this defense because of the rest of the question marks around the secondary. It's almost like we kind of are like, well, we have our cornerback one, let's worry about cornerback two. And it's like, well, do we have that lockdown guy? Like, is Tae Banks going to be fine to go up against Justin Jefferson in week one? Is Tae Banks going to be able to handle Terry McLaurin or CeeDee Lamb or AJ Brown one-on-one on a continual basis? Like, That's the division that he's in, and he needs to be able to perform at that level. Adam, I'm concerned, because if he cannot do what we need him to do as cornerback one, then it almost doesn't even matter what's going on around him. There's so many other question marks that we have. We have to have him solidified as a cornerback one, and he has to play a little bit better than what we've seen in the preseason.
Listen, does he need to take the next leap forward? Of course he does. He was targeted. I mean, listen, we always say like PFF grades, and we're going to use them here in a minute, so I can't talk out of both sides of my mouth and say it only matters when it looks good, but not when it's bad. He was graded out as a 51.4 per PFF, but he was targeted 92 times a year ago and gave up just 53 receptions, had two interceptions, 56 solo tackles, for what it's worth. My stance here on this is, one, though the results are the results when it comes to practice, and we would want to praise Darius Slayton for saying, hey, got behind the defense and went for a deep touchdown, right? 70-yard bomb off the arm of Daniel Jones. But what is the intention of the defensive play designs throughout the course of camp? And that's not dismissing issues that Tae Banks may be having, getting burned, but just the reality of, tell me what he's trying to focus on right now. Is he focusing on his jamming at the line of scrimmage and being disruptive on the routes? Okay. Is he doing as much of that in camp when you're taking on teammates, as opposed to when you get into joint practices or when you get into preseason games, when you're going to be as physical as you want to be on game day potentially? Maybe those are caveats. It's certainly possible. I think the reality here is one, as you mentioned, is he ready to go on and take on the likes of a Justin Jefferson? Well, the one thing that I could tell you is, if I go look at Justin Jefferson's stats, you tell me who's been able to go on and take on Justin Jefferson on a week-over-week basis. It's a losing battle. It's a losing premise to say who's going to shut down the best wide receiver. He had 12, 5, 6, 7, only two games in the entirety of last year did he have less than 5-plus catches, and those are the only two games, against the Raiders and against the Kansas City Chiefs, where he had anything less than 80-plus yards, excluding the 5 on 10 targets for 59 against Green Bay. That's the kind of player that he is. Like, that's the elite talent. So I think the question would be, can Tae Banks go up against the best in the league and hold him to some of these average kind of stat lines, right? You look in those games and you say, it's a win if you only give up 6 catches, but for 85 yards, that means that you didn't give up an explosive play. That was against Carolina, maybe a game that didn't matter score-wise, right? If you can be in a position where you keep things in front of you, which is what we're talking about with some of these deep throws in camp, that's the big question, and probably the thing we won't know until week one, by the way, against Justin Jefferson, and whether or not Tae Banks can afford to be physical at the line and then also still have that recovery speed to be there on the back end on some of these deep throws.
Well, so the issue for me is, Adam, it's not just about Justin Jefferson being amazing and like, oh, it's a one-off. Justin Jefferson's a top 3 wide receiver in the league. Like, who can
every team's going to have one of these guys at least?
That's kind of my point is, like, they start with Justin Jefferson, then they move over to Terry McLaurin. You can say whatever you want of how high you think he's ranked. And then, you know, obviously they get Amari Cooper, kind of like middle of the road. You expect him to be able to match up against a wide receiver one like him. Then you go to CeeDee Lamb, DK Metcalf, Ja'Marr Chase, AJ Brown, George Pickens. Like, that, yeah, that is murderer's row of top 12 wide receivers in the league. And so, like, for whatever it's worth, Tae Banks has to be a top 15 cornerback in the league to be able to give the Giants an opportunity in the secondary.
Oh, no, 100%. And by the way, why? Let's go ahead and open it up here a little bit, because the rest of the secondary, like, this is, I think, kind of my point. Now, listen, when you come in and you're an elite shutdown corner early in your career, it's like you just see it. You know it, right? And all of a sudden, by the way, though, you can look right across, right? When we talk about Sauce Gardner, well, his rookie year was, hey, watch out. This kid is a lock it up cornerback. Year two, still good at times, but also had stretches where he struggled, where it did not look as clean, right? So sometimes you come in and you depend more on instincts than you do on technique. And then, okay, year over year, you have to develop that. I'd like to think that we'll see Tae Banks start to take that next step forward when it comes to marrying natural instincts and then having really strong quality technique. But in totality, so if we go beyond Tae Banks and say, okay, let's see what he looks like in year number two. The bigger question for me is, what's happening in the rest of the secondary? You heard Brian Daboll talk yesterday. Okay, Jalen Mills, yeah, we don't know. He's still not ready. Now, he's a veteran in the secondary. It's why Pinnick, a starter, is playing with the backup reps, because you need somebody out there, and they're thin in that room right now. But then you go into the rest of the secondary where Drew Phillips, okay, looked good in the first game. dealing with a minor injury, nothing major, but he's a rookie, not getting reps right now. Cordell Flott hasn't been in there. He's the guy you want to see get on the outside. And now the question I have for you, and it's like, do you feel bolstered by what you saw in preseason game number one in some other players, and we can highlight the PFF grades that Trey Hawkins had? Or are we sitting here and saying, when we come to this cutdown date, which I mentioned yesterday, it's the end of August, and we're going to have this sprint to bring in maybe two or even three bodies into this room?
Yeah, so you mentioned Jason Pinnick. I feel like Jason Pinnick is in line for a huge year this year for the Giants. Like,
And I'm only bringing him up because he has to be out there because they don't feel confident putting other players in the mix.
It feels like Jason Pinnick and Tae Banks are the only two that you're like, you can't take them off the field. They have to be on the field. Everyone else in the secondary, you could make an argument for Tyler Newbin, Dane Belton, Nick McCloud, Cordell. Nickel corner. Like, you can make an argument for a whole host of people, but Jason Pinnick and Tae Banks have to be the two people that you can hang your hat on. I think you bring up a good point where, and we've mentioned this before, you know, when we talk about cut candidates from other teams and bringing people in, that's been the reality for the Giants. They have brought in a few different players off of some, you know, Mario Goodrich is a guy that just came in, I believe. Christian Holmes was another guy that the team brought in. There's quite a few guys that they're just claiming to try to figure out how this works. Breon Borders came over from the Philadelphia Eagles. The Giants are going to do more and more of that as we get closer to week one. Don't be surprised if there's two or three new corners for the last preseason game that they're going to find out if they can make the back of the roster, because there's only a handful of guys that you feel will make it in the secondary for sure. Outside of that, it feels like there's one or two roster spots that's wide open, even for guys that aren't even on the roster right now.
No, and that's not necessarily a bad thing, because we came into it. So I think when Dan Duggan brings this up and saying, are some of these other things overshadowing it? We focus a lot. And it's why when he talked about, hey, right now, Daniel Jones has looked pretty good in camp. So take that for what it's worth. Stop thinking about it as a year or two ago. Offensive line play. Hey, our first sample of it in the preseason one looked pretty good, even though it's the backups. Okay, we'll get a sample on Saturday against Houston. Assume that if it looks pretty good, then it's going to be pretty good. The secondary is where you have these questions. And sometimes, whether it's maybe Jalen Hyatt and right rookie Malik Nabers, Darius Slayton, the more that you hear that in practices, a lot of these guys are getting open and doing great things. That is exciting, but there's been times when we've said in the past, but is that indicative of what's happening on the other side of the football? One of the things too is that I find interesting about this is when we talk about who's been getting reps, and Nick McCloud, he's playing at the nickel. He's also playing on the outside. This is a classic follow the money scenario. I mean, listen, he's 26 years old. He has familiarity. I'm not downplaying him at all. But depending on who becomes available when you get to the cutdown days, he has a zero dead cap hit if they release him, and they'll free up $3 million in that process. So you have to look at some of these things when it comes to the Giants and say, what is it going to look like if they make that decision? And how can they free up additional money for the team to go get player X? So take away two or three players and it turns into someone else. And some people had said, and I think maybe you and I were late to this party about ultimately the Giants are going to go get a veteran to play across from Tae Banks. I kept pushing back on that. And we can talk about some of the other guys that have performed well to this point. Do you think that that is more likely now? That it is just about, hey, what's the baseline here? How do we guarantee that when we line up, if Tae Banks is going up against Justin Jefferson and he does win 2, 3, 4, 5 reps, big reps in the course of a game, we don't automatically go, yeah, but then unfortunately wide receiver 2 or 3 got absolutely torched on our other side and went for big plays. Like, I think that that's the thing you need to safeguard against if you're Shane Bowen and the Giants D.
The people that follow the team closest are fully convinced that the Giants are not getting a veteran. They're just not. Even with having, I believe it's $9.8 million in cap space was the latest thing that I had heard.
And that's not enough to make any moves right now.
No, I mean, maybe you could sign a guy for what, $3 million or something, and then release somebody else.
Yeah.
You can make
the same amount that Nick McCloud is making. So where would your confidence level be in a player like
right.
that?
Right. You'd be dropping Nick McCloud and having zero dead cap to sign someone for $3 million that you think is better than Nick McCloud. But who's out there for $3 million that's better than that? The Giants probably would have signed him already. But you talk about Xavien Howard, you talk about Stephon Gilmore. Mm-hmm. These are guys that are going to command $8 to $10 million, even in the late stages of free agency. And so, like, the Giants aren't in that position. I am convinced that the people closest to the team have been told, we got to figure this out. we got enough bodies in there. Someone has to come up. And I think it would also be an admission of guilt if they went out and signed a veteran alongside Tae Banks at this point, because they did draft Cordell Flott. They have Darnay Holmes. They have Nick McLeod. They have all these players that are familiar with the Giants organization, and they're like, just figure it out. Jalen Mills is a guy that's been on the non-football injury list. He plays safety, corner, nickel corner. He could do a whole host of things. He's guaranteed $500,000, but we haven't seen him yet. I think the Giants are saying, we have the bodies. We just need to figure it out. Unless someone else comes along that's on a veteran minimum that got cut that we think could potentially make this roster, I don't feel like you're going to see a 29-year-old, 30-year-old veteran for $7 million come to the Giants and instantly solve their cornerback two problem.
No, you wouldn't think so. And this is, again, to bring it back to the top and talk about how the Giants have built their roster, because the offensive line went veteran heavy in the offseason. That does change to me, in my opinion. We'll talk about probably what we have a week in between before we get into the week prep for the regular season. So that's when we'll do our predictions, records, and where we think this team is going to finish. But when you bring in a lot more veterans, it does make me go, okay, that changes how I think you should perform this year, and it changes expectations. In the secondary, we haven't seen that yet to this point, right? They went with youth. So there is this marriage being valued here, and it comes down to only having a little bit less than $10 million in cap space. If we had more, maybe we would have done more, right? But you have to at some point say, the players we have, which are a lot of young talent as well, some of these guys are going to have to come to fruition. And we've seen it in some other spots on the roster. And that's why my closeout here, when we think about the Pro Football Focus grades that came out of this, you do have to. We came out of that game. We said, boy, Darian Beavers, guys in the linebacking room perform pretty darn well. Well, Trey Hawkins, yeah, we get it. He looked absolutely brutal a year ago. But so far, 34 total reps, 20 in coverage, a 90.4 grade. That has to mean something. You look at a guy like David Logg Jr. Okay, 23 total reps, 16 in coverage, 77.3. That has to mean something. Like, at some point, this is the group of players you have. And because they are either drafted talent or specifically targeted players that you brought in the beginning of the offseason and in free agency, a few of these guys have to hit. Jarvarius Owens in the secondary. These guys just need to hit. And not, it doesn't mean elite starters. They just have to be contributors. And that, I think that's always been the premise for Shane Bowen going back to Hard Knocks. What they say, we get you Brian Burns, that's all you get. And then you got to figure out the rest. And this is now the time for new defensive coordinator Shane Bowen to figure out the rest. And a part of that is going to be, how do you cover all these great talents across the NFL with a secondary that is very much going to be a work in progress?
At the end of the day,
sure,
the Giants have a huge task in front of them in the next preseason game against the Houston Texans. You're talking about CJ Stroud emerging as one of the top 10 quarterbacks in the NFL. And you have guys like Nico Collins, Tank Dell. I don't know if we're going to see Stephon Diggs out there or how long we are. This is going to be a very big test for this secondary coming up on Saturday, Adam. And this is the perfect time where Cordell Flott has to be out there playing. Nick McLeod has to be out there playing. You have to have these guys getting reps. Trey Hawkins has to be out there. If it doesn't go well and the Giants seem puzzled by the cornerback play against CJ Stroud and the Texans, even in a handful of series that he's going to play, that's going to be the point where you may have to ring the alarm bell and say, we don't have the guy on the roster alongside Tae Banks. So for me, I'm looking at Saturday, and we're going to go through the preview later this week in terms of what to expect from that. This is a really good test, and we need all of those players out there to see whether or not they can handle this come week one.
No, 100%. And that's why, so we had recorded, this is going back a couple of days, we took a look at the PFF grades, in totality coming out of that Lions game and went through both sides of the football. That'll be what you can find tomorrow morning. I think that's a good way to break down, set the table for who we want to get a deeper look at and watch for. Thankfully, because we saw Tyrone Tracy Jr. go down and then also seemingly come back from that injury in terms of a long-term stance, you can still absorb all the things that we talk about without really worrying about injury impact and otherwise. We're still in a pretty good spot, as Andy said at the top. Mostly a healthy roster for the New York Football Giants. So you can see that breakdown. And then on Friday, we'll focus in on what are the matchups that we'll watch. If it's two series of starters on starters, if it's three series starters on starters, we need to take every single ounce of data that we can out of that and project it going forward. Where's the depth on the offensive line? who steps up in the secondary for the Giants, and then, of course, key position battles. But as I highlighted yesterday, Andy, when you don't have to cut down until the 53-man roster until the end of August 27th, that's the other part of this. You're just going to see 30-odd, 40-odd players drop off of rosters across the league and then a mad scramble to the final claim date on the 28th at noon. That's going to be a lot of fun for us. Bottom line being, some quick things to let you know. You get us on YouTube, as we always say. Went live yesterday. If something else breaks, maybe we'll go live again. You want to be turned on for that. Podcast feed, please, please, please go subscribe. Give us that 5-star review. Support our sponsors. And just fired up a Discord server recently. We'll put that in the show notes. So on game day, you can go ahead and chat with us, but you can also leave voice notes about all the key plays that you think won or maybe lost the game for the New York Football Giants. So expanding the way that we can interact with you all season long. Do all those great things. And in the meantime, for the best of times, as Andrew Mackowitz would want, need, and demand the people know.
As always, let's go big blue.